How's it going, everybody, and welcome to Coffering Tales. Today, I want to have a quick look at one of my favorite deities from the ancient world, the opener of ways, Anubis. So, sit down, grab a cup of coffee, and let me tell you a story. Anubis, also known as Anpu, is the ancient Egyptian god of the dead, mummification, guardian of the scales, and protector of the tombs. He's commonly depicted with the head of a wolf, widely known as the African golden wolf, which, fun fact, is frequently mistaken for a jackal based on its appearance. He's the guide and protector of the dead, the one who would weigh your heart to judge your soul. Based on his judgment, you would continue to Aru and everlasting life, or your heart would be consumed by Amut, resulting in your second and final death. This process is described in the Book of the Dead as follows. The dead would be brought into the hall, namely the hall of the double Ma'at, by the goddess of truth. The dead would then declare themselves innocent by reciting the 42 negative confessions. These are basically things like, I didn't murder anyone, I haven't stolen anything, I haven't blasphemed, stuff like that. Your heart would then be presented to Anubis and placed onto the scales. The feather of Ma'at, known as the feather of truth, would be placed on the other scale and weighed against the heart. Thoth, who would be standing on the right side of the scales, would then state both the deeds and the sins of the deceased. He would then record the results of the weighing. At this point, things can go into one of two directions. If the heart is lighter than the feather, then the dead are not burdened by sin and would be brought to meet the Lord of the Dead, Osiris. He would then allow them to proceed to Aru. If the heart is heavier, it would be consumed by Amut, killing the deceased's very soul, resulting in a final death. Based on the Osiris myth, Anubis's origin is a rather scandalous one, you could say. He was the child of Osiris and Nephthys. She was the wife of Set, who we know from the mythos as jealous and a big fan of warfare and rebellion. According to some accounts, she lusted after Osiris. She proceeded to change her form to that of Isis, Osiris's queen consort. Master sent and waited for Osiris in his bed in low light. Osiris, thinking that she was Isis, slept with her, and she became pregnant. Fearing Set's wrath, she cast the child away after birth. Isis found out about the child and searched for him. And after she found him, she took him in and raised him as her guardian, naming him Anubis. Unfortunately for Anubis, Set also discovered Nephthys' infidelity. Understandably, Set was not essentially upbeat about the affair. This led to some, let's say, unpleasant things to come. Set devised a plan to get rid of Osiris and usurp him in the process. At a royal feast that was held for Osiris, Set issued a challenge. Whoever fitted precisely in the chest that he brought would receive it. Naturally, it was made to fit only Osiris. When Osiris lay down in it, Set's conspirators shut the chest and sealed it with lead. They then proceeded to toss it into the Nile, and it flowed out to sea. Isis, hearing what happened, was grief-stricken. After cutting off some of her hair and dressing in mourning clothes, she started searching for her husband's remains, accompanied by seven scorpions who served as her protectors, and Anubis. After some misunderstandings involving the scorpions and a child, news came about the whereabouts of the coffin containing Osiris. It made its way to the shores of Syria, encased in the body of a sacred tree. Needless to say, they made haste to Syria. After some more misunderstandings involving a baby and a lot of fire, she got hold of the coffin and took it back to Egypt. At this point, she hid the coffin and went to Horus. As they left, Set appeared and found the sarcophagus. He was rather upset to see the body of his brother. He then proceeded to cut his brother into 14 pieces and threw them into the Nile, hoping the crocodiles would eat the pieces. The crocodiles did not dare touch any of the pieces, as they feared the wrath of Isis. But a single fish was oblivious, and he ate the, phallus of Osiris. Again, Isis found out what Set had done, and, grief-stricken once more, set out to find the pieces with the help of her sister Nephthys. They ended up finding the parts, well, 13 of them, with the help of Anubis, and in some versions of the story, Thoth and Horus. They brought the pieces back together. They also fashioned a golden phallus to replace the one that the fish had eaten. But seeing as his body was not complete with his own flesh, he could not return to the world of the living. Anubis then began to perform the first mummification on Osiris. Now, in some versions of the myth, Set made another attempt to get rid of Osiris. Just one problem though, he did not factor in Anubis. In this version of the myth, Set disguised himself as a leopard and attempted to attack them and destroy Osiris' body once and for all. Anubis grabbed Set and branded his whole body with a hot iron. He then flayed Set's leopard body and wore his bloody skin as a warning to all evildoers. And that, kids, is why leopards have spots and the priests in ancient Egypt wore leopard skins. Well, after this altercation between Set and Anubis, the burial rites were completed. Osiris was sent to the underworld, and Anubis stepped down from the ruler of the underworld so that his father could take over the position. And that's the basic overview of Anubis's backstory, so to say. If you enjoyed the video, hit the like button and share your thoughts. If not, hit the dislike and let me know where I can improve. Till next time, see you later.